Welcome, everyone. Welcome, everyone. For those of you who have been joining us for the past few showcases, thanks for coming back. And for those of you who this is your first time at a showcase, welcome. My name is Maddie Mitchell, and I'm one of the directors for the Council of Sustainable Leaders. We host this weekly showcase series to present the various aspects of sustainability, which range from gender equality to water access to responsible consumption. This semester, we will be providing meals by Paul's Provisions, who prepare a variety of meals with vegan and vegetarian options. Everything inside your container is actually compostable, so make sure that on your way out, you put it in the green box back there. As you came in, you may have noticed cards on your table with an image and a quote. These We and Me cards were created by Will Wise, who works with Shavers Creek and World in Conversation to facilitate connection before content. I hope that you are able to meet some people around you and hear an image or quote may connect you with one another. Today we will have Karen Winterich, who is a professor of marketing at Penn State. She will be speaking about from disposable to reusable and sustainable. In honor of today's talk, discussing reusable products, the Council of Sustainable Leaders is providing each attendee with a free metal straw for the cleaner at the end. So be sure to grab one on the way out. I'll be handing them out. Let's give a warm welcome to Karen Winterich.
Thank you, Maddie. Well, thank you, everyone. I am very excited to be here today. A little less excited a couple weeks ago when I was at my daughter's open house at school and a parent friend said, "Oh, I'm really interested in your talk." And I was like, "Right, I gotta get that ready." So I wasn't excited then, but now I'm excited because I think it's ready. I hope so. So as Maddie said, we are going to talk a bit today about how we live, maybe surprisingly, maybe not so much, in a very disposable society. And hopefully when you leave, you'll think a little bit more about reuse and also simultaneously reduction. So that's basically the goal of today. But for now, do we have a Michael Mann repeat? Da-da-da! We'll see what happens here. But so marketing. I'm going to go ahead and just answer the question in the room that may be lingering in your mind, like, what were they thinking when they invited a marketing professor? Isn't marketing and business the root of all evil? Isn't this what's gotten us to this problem in the first place? Yes and no. I can admit that all marketing is not good marketing, for sure, right? So that definitely can be a part of the problem. But marketing can also sell ideas and change behaviors. And so I hope that we can be part of the solution to the problem that we may have started to create. Another reason, perhaps, why we're talking about marketing is because marketing is the only business function whose purpose is to generate revenue. You might think that's just advertising, communications. It's a part of it. But it's also supposed to drive sales. How do we drive sales? We give consumers, you guys, myself included, what they want, right? Or that's hopefully the goal. So what we're going to do is kind of take a little step back in time, look at some things that marketers have given us, products, that we wanted, right? But maybe now we realize they're not that beneficial, or the benefits, maybe the costs are outweighing those benefits. So that's kind of where we're going to step into. Doug, thank you. So this is a picture, advertisement actually, that was originally in Life magazine in 1955. Now, it just so happens that Maddie emailed me this summer and said, "Hey, do you want to do this? And what's your big idea?" And I was looking through the June 2018 National Geographic and was like, disposable society, changing that, my big idea. And so this is kind of what started it all off, and I had to include this. But in 1955, this image was celebrating a throwaway society, a throwaway living, the convenience of it all, right? And how do we really get here? Well, it actually kind of happened that plastics were sort of developed as part of World War II. They were looking for materials innovation, so they started forming all these different kind of materials, some of which were plastics, which led to, wow, after the war, we can actually produce consumer goods with these plastics. Very basic history lesson. I am not a history expert, but that's what I gather. So we ended up with all of these kind of disposable goods. Yes, they're convenient. Yes, they make life easier. I get that, but there's also a cost involved. Something that resonates with me is diapers, disposable diapers. I am proud to say that my children are now both out of diapers, so I don't have guilt anymore. But this was also kind of part of the plastics, new materials innovation. So in the 60s, they're developing disposable diapers, and they're becoming much more popular across the next couple decades. Huge waste, huge convenience, right? So this is just something that resonated with me, but I'm sure you can all think in your life about something that we just constantly throw out and it's disposable, we don't even think about it. And what really resonated with me, not specifically for diapers, but I was in class, I think it was actually, I didn't think about this. A student told me about how they didn't, we were talking about nutrition labeling, and how that, for many students in here, you never knew life without a nutrition label. Guess what, I lived when there was no nutrition label, and many other people in here did too, right? We were talking about environmental labels, and they were thinking about how, wow, so that's why my grandparents make food from scratch. Or, you know, like, they didn't have takeout, and they didn't have delivery, and they didn't really even have that many dining out options, right? So they just used what they got at the local grocer, maybe some meats from the butcher, and they prepared their meal. And that had a lot less waste, you know, because they would use the meat, and then the bone would also be used to make soup, and they were not very wasteful at all. And that society is, go talk to your great-grandparents, students, because otherwise you're never gonna know that society, right? But there's kind of some lost information and value, how we went from that to our current kind of everyday society. But maybe this is not really resonating with you. Marketers also give consumers what they want, in that they might give them experiences and feelings. Sometimes that might actually be excessive packaging. So I have a little video here. It's a long video, but we're only gonna show a few seconds of it. Some of you may be familiar with Beats by Dre.
On research and testing, but they go to the next level with packaging and advertising. First of all, Beats by Dre packaging is, I think, easily the best in any headphones out there. No shame in admitting that. They're just the best package. The presentation, the colors, the imagery, the accessories you get inside, everything about the unboxing experience of a pair of Beats by Dre trumps anything Audio-Technica has ever done, and they spend money to do that. But really, it's about the advertising. You've heard of Beats by Dre.
So it is about the advertising, it is about the brand image, and I'm guessing that at least one person in this room has shelled out multiple hundreds of dollars to maybe own a pair of these headphones, right? I'm not an audio quality expert, but from what I hear, objectively their sound quality is not actually all that awesome, and if you want to watch a 7-minute video to tell you about it, you can do that. But the experience, the brand image, and the packaging, there are videos of people opening their Beats headphones, and maybe it's not Beats for you, maybe it's something else. But there are lots of pictures or videos of people opening, packaging excessively. And I even lived this when I had some of my children and some co-authors who happened to study sustainability would send me baby clothes made from organic cotton with 10 layers of packaging to unwrap that would go in the trash can, maybe recycling if we were lucky, right? So it just doesn't make sense, but yet we as consumers like this unboxing experience. We like this excessive packaging. But Do we want to? Do we need to? Have we ever even stopped to think about it before? It's kind of the question that I'm getting at a little bit today. So moving on from kind of packaging waste, we can also think about how we've shifted to thinking that even things that are supposed to be durable are now disposable. Now I showed this commercial clip in my class last semester, and see if you notice what I'm talking about here with durables have become disposable. What was in there that's actually a durable that was treated as disposable? Sorry for my kid theme in this. The binky, the pacifier, the sippy cup, right? Oh, the dog picks it up. The sippy cup drops in the mud. Let me just reorder that real quick. You can wash plastic sippy cups. Like, they're washable. You can clean them. You can disinfect them. Like, they're reusable. They're durable, okay? But we don't seem to recognize that anymore. Everything is so cheap. Again, the invention of plastics, you know, we're not paying for maybe these wood, you know, metal materials. And so who wants to wash that? I'm just gonna go ahead and spend $5 and buy a new one, right? And that's kind of the mentality that we've gotten into. So we had a huge discussion about this in class. Now I do wanna give credit, Walmart on their supply chain end has done many actually very sustainable things. But in terms of the consumerism end, in terms of selling high quality durable goods, less so, right? And so we've gotten to this point. Beyond sippy cups, we are also thinking about clothing, more so as maybe a disposable good. So in the last, say, I'm sure the numbers have only gone up since here, but just in about 15 years, we increased our clothing purchases by 60%. Maybe that in itself is not necessarily a problem, but the part that I've got highlighted here is that we've kept each garment half as long. That is a problem, right? So moving on, we just another statistic here, almost 70 garments each year. I did some really quick math for you here. That's basically buying one new garment every 5 days. And I know you're like, well, yeah, that's other people, that's not actually me, but wait, if I go shopping once every 2 weeks and get 2 or 3 items, or once a month and get 4 or 5 items, suddenly that is 70 things per year or more, and that's not even counting the holidays, right? Or other gift buying occasions, right? Oh, but you guys feel okay in here because you donate the clothing, right? So when you're donating it, it's gonna go to somebody else and make them feel good, but not so much. Only 20% of donated clothing actually ends up being resold. Because guess what? Nobody else wants your $3 t-shirt either, right? Because there's only 10 million of the $3 t-shirts in the pile. So it's actually not that helpful. And even worse yet is that 75 to 85% of the clothing in America doesn't even get donated. It ends up in the landfill. So of that clothing being resold, that's 20% of 25% of all clothing. That's not very much, right? So we can do better than that, would be what I hope we can kind of get out of it. So just kind of summarizing all that little trip through history, so far we know that it's cheap, right? We've gotten new materials innovation, things have gotten a lot cheaper and more accessible. We can just find them. We can go to Walmart and buy everything we need, or Target, or Amazon, guilty as charged. Just let me be clear about this. I might try to stand up here and say some things like we can do better and we can change and maybe a little bit of guilt in there. I am not guilt-free. I do things many times, and I'm like, that was not sustainable. I'm a hypocrite. So I'm definitely not saying that I am perfect in any of these respects, but I think that we can all together get better. But things in general are cheaper, and they're more accessible, and they're more convenient. And so we're busier as consumers. We travel more, we do more, we have more dual-income households, which means we have more people working, less time to cook from scratch, et cetera, right? So we want these disposable kind of throwaway living ideas. There's another problem that I think, which we might be a little bit less aware of, we can't see it, right? So what we actually see, or what we actually don't see, is the landfill, right? This is what we're creating, okay? And way more than that. But this is what we see. A nice little garbage can at the end of the driveway. It's all pretty and contained in there, and like, let's try not to smell it or get too close. And maybe for the college students, maybe it's a little bit harder. They might have to go to the dumpster. We did a project in class and they talked about the garbage juice around the dumpster, like, ooh. But still, they're not hauling it away. Many of you guys may even have trash chutes. Just like literally open it, dump, never see it again, right? So out of sight, out of mind. Not only are we buying things because they're cheap and convenient, but we don't ever have to think about the end, the waste, the disposal component. And so I'm hoping that we can kind of reverse this today, start to see the waste, and think about what we can do through that. So, from a business perspective, because I am giving you kind of the business, the marketing side, what's happening is, oh, this is lots of clicks here. I did really funny animation with this, okay? Not that fun, but you know, for me it was challenging. But basically, we have the environmental resources, which we're taking to make materials, to make products, to waste. But this is kind of where many businesses cut off, and then it's on the consumer down here. Now, unfortunately, the businesses may not give us many options of how to get rid of that waste. But what we see happening is that our waste is just piling up and piling up and piling up. And so the answer to this, somebody say recycle. Recycle, right? So we can just consume as much as we want if we recycle. But that's actually not that good of an answer either. Yes, it's better than throwing in the landfill if it can be recycled, but that's like the last resort that we wanna have. We wanna go back to the beginning of the process and say, do we even need this packaging to recycle in the first place? Because it still takes more resources to recycle than it does to just reduce and reuse in the first place. So I am marketing, specifically consumer psychology. So I study this nice theoretical decision process a lot. But what I'm going to argue is that currently we don't think about needs awareness very little. True needs, definitely, but even wants. We don't even really think about if we want something, maybe. Everything's so cheap, we're definitely not thinking about evaluating alternatives or information source. Purchase decision, sure, it's cheap, it's easy, it's convenient, let's buy it. And then the post-purchase, I don't have to see it, right? I don't have to think about what happens after that. So again, today, hopefully we're gonna focus on the post-purchase. Actually think about what's in our waste can, all right? And then we're gonna think about the needs part. After we see our waste, do we even want it? Is there a better way to kind of get rid of it? And ultimately hoping to reduce our purchases, reducing our waste and our consumption. So that's what we're kind of where we're going for what's left of this talk today. And I'm happy to answer questions, of course, afterwards. So seeing our own waste, kind of click through here pretty quick, Doug. But let's take a little trash can. Plastic bags, we know that. Coffee cups, all disposable, all disposable, all disposable. Water bottles, takeout containers, right? All those toiletries or free samples in small little tiny containers. Even t-shirts, which we now know are often ending up in the landfill, right? So this is, oh, my personal pet peeve. We just got over career fair, or we're in the middle of career fair season. All of that swag, trinket, junk, depends how you wanna look at it, right? But ultimately, I'm gonna guess that once you get home with your book bag full of awesome freebies, you're like, oh, what am I gonna do with this? I'm gonna put it in the trash can. So, hopefully we're gonna step back through and look at these items and think about how we could reduce our consumption. So, what can you do? One is actually try to consciously think before you accept something, anything. Can we just say no to free stuff? Now, I'll admit, free stuff is a little bit of like a high. Like, just say no to drugs, just say no to free, like, you get, look what I got for free! This is awesome! I don't know that I want it, but like, it was free, so it was clearly the best thing I've ever gotten in my life, right? It's actually not that awesome. So we could start to say no to free stuff, all right? Because there is an environmental cost. Like, there's no free lunch, except for today. But there's an environmental cost involved, okay? So some things we could say no to, certainly I would love it if at some point, I might get in trouble with some recruiters, I don't know, but I would love it if at some point our student groups rose up and said, you can come to recruit, but we don't want your trinkets. We don't want your swag because they end up in the landfill, right? So you come recruit us, but we don't have to have all that extra waste coming along with you. And similarly, something that might seem out there, but it resonates with me, I have a pile of free t-shirts from like signing up for 5Ks and stuff. I can't wear that many t-shirts, right? So, and they're not, of course, that high quality. And we get t-shirts for all sorts of things. So what if we said no to those too? Now, initially, that's not gonna help reduce much waste because they order a set amount of t-shirts, et cetera, they're just gonna go somewhere anyway. But what if we started doing this time after time after time, and organizations, oh, I don't have to order that many shirts. Maybe I don't even want shirts to be my giveaway. Maybe I give out something, nothing. Or I could just give out something that's reusable, right? We kind of change the way that we think about things, or even just making the freebie not the default, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. So those are some things we can just say no to. And we can also say no to the plastic bag, right? Now, I am very happy to say that we do have down here in the hub, the eco coin, right? So hopefully at the bookstore downstairs, you guys are aware that actually you can say no to plastic bags. They're going to encourage you to do that by donating to an organization. So that is one thing we can think about. And it does take a little bit of planning, yes. We all know there's reusable bags. There's also reusable produce bags. So if you're like, well, you know, for produce, I need that. You could use those instead of the little tiny clear, they're not even good for reuse. I mean, you could at least like line your garbage can with the other plastic bags, but those are really good for hardly anything except for the 3 seconds to put your produce in it, take it home and throw it out again, right? Maybe recycle it, but they're not that good of recyclable value either. So we have to kind of start to think about planning for reuse. So it does take effort. I'm not gonna sit here and be like, or stand here, and tell you guys, it's so easy, you don't even have to think about reuse. You do. It's gonna be a little bit more challenging than just throwing everything out. But I would counter that with, it's not gonna be quite as hard as you think. A lot of what we do is just habits. And we can form new habits somewhat effortlessly. And then once we do it, we're reducing. We're minimizing our waste, right? So I would love to never see this, and you're like, well, that's extreme. Okay, I'll give you that. But it's not that extreme. How many times you walk past campus or somewhere else after a big event, and it's overflowing with coffee cups or water bottles or something, right? Something disposable. So what we can do is think about bringing our own cup. Now I'm gonna pick on Penn State a little bit, because we have not gotten rid of the disposable cup yet. Now I know there's lots of conversations about it, and I am hoping we get there sooner rather than later, but we have not started this yet. But that doesn't mean you can't bring your own cup. You can't have your own movement, right? Well, I gotta remember, I always forget, you know, it's hard to remember my cup, et cetera. Okay, there's an option for that, that you can actually have an app that will do this for you. So Ripple is an app, sponsored, there's an app for that, right? There's an app for everything. There's an app for that, and that Ocean Conservancy has an app called Ripple. You can set a reminder, if you leave your house at 8:55 every morning, set your reminder for 8:54, and it's gonna pop up and say, grab your mug. Okay, do that for a week or two. And guess what? You're not gonna need it again. It's gonna be a new habit that's already formed. Or you know what? If you don't like smartphones, put a post-it note on your door. That works too, right? So we just have to put a little bit of effort in at first to change our behavior, and then it becomes our new behavior, and we're not piling up disposable cups anymore. Lots of other things that we can think about. I'm very happy to see lots of water bottles here today, reusable water bottles. So that's good. You can click through here. There's lots of stuff up here. Keep clicking, because I like my little animations. Reusable silverware. I had a student who told me that this is good. She had an insight. Kind of hopefully I'm having, hoping that you're having some insights today too. She admitted in class that, wow, she used to like pick up takeout and grab as many spoons and forks as she could, so she never had to wash them at home. She never once thought about the environmental impact of that. And then she's like, oh, I guess I could just wash them. I guess I could just wash them, right? It's not that hard to wash a spoon or a fork. But the problem is that we're not even thinking that way, right? So I'm hoping that we're at least starting to, you know, it doesn't mean everything's gonna change tomorrow, but if we start thinking in baby steps, we can start to make a difference. Disposable napkins, right? I never really thought about this one that much. I mean, you could compost those. My kids' preschool is zero waste. They tell the parents, pack a cloth placemat, a cloth napkin, and then pack a lunch that doesn't have a lot of packaging. Ooh, you can pack a lunch without like applesauce pouches? What? You can, it's amazing, right? And we send in reusable napkins. So much less waste, right? So these are options. How hard is it to throw a few napkins in with every little laundry? Not hard, right? So we could do that and reduce waste. Now this last one, my kids love Sweet Frog. Again, the kid theme carrying through here. But I hate going because I hate the amount of waste we produce in like 10 minutes of having some frozen yogurt. You know, a bowl for each of us, a bowl bigger than we need for each of us, a spoon, you know, napkin. It's ridiculous. Now, this is not an easy solution. I was listening to a panel of different restaurant executives, and we were talking exactly about kind of this issue of reuse of silverware, reuse of containers, and it's a branding issue. From a marketing perspective, just like Beats by Dre are selling you the brand, whatever silverware they use, whatever dish they use, that's part of their brand. So I don't have a solution for how exactly we can get non-disposable but reusable takeout containers, but we can get there. We have to recognize it's an issue and work on it. Some places, we'll talk about zero waste, you can bring your own container. So we'll work on that a little bit. And at Penn State, they are working to, oops, that might have been me. Does this actually work now?
No.
Oh, never mind. Penn State has the green to go container. I'm hoping some of you know about that a little bit. Yay, yay. Okay, if you don't, now you do. No excuses. At many, I think five different dining halls on campus, you can pay $5 to get this reusable container, and then you can return it, get the next one, get your food, return. Just gotta rinse it out, right? Not incredibly hard. So there are ways to start to work around. Now maybe there's less of a branding issue for Penn State Dining Services, I'm not sure, than there might be for Sweet Frog. But nonetheless, there are ways to start to think about reusing containers instead of just disposing of everything. There's also some other options that we can do and businesses can do. So some of you buy from order from Grubhub, I'm guessing, maybe. Has anyone ever noticed, spare me the napkins and plasticware, I'm trying to save the earth? Anyone? Okay, it's on there, all right? You could click that little box. It's not very well marketed, it's not very well positioned, but it's an option. Very few people are using it, okay? So we have to change what we're doing. We have to start making things, go ahead, next one here, the default option. Now we're talking about spoons and napkins. This is a relatively famous study in my little world by Johnson and Goldstein of organ donation. Organs, not plastic spoons and napkins, okay? Whenever you have to opt in, like say, yes, I want to be organ donor, like the US, you only get about 15-20% of people participating. But whenever you have to opt out and say, no, I don't want to be an organ donor, otherwise you are, whoa, like 99% participation. Everyone does it. So what if you didn't have to opt in to be sustainable? You had to opt out to not be, right? It's not that hard of a change to make. One example here is what we're doing, seeing a lot of companies doing now with plastic straws, right? A lot of companies would still have them behind the counter, but they changed the default option. Instead of giving it to you without you even thinking or asking, you have to consciously say, I really need that straw. Could you please give me a straw, right? And you won't have to anymore because, as Maddie said at the beginning, everyone here today gets a reusable metal straw. But something as simple as that, right, changing the default, changing what consumers have to take an effort to opt into or opt out of, can drastically, by like 80%+, change the number of people that participate. So those are things that you can push for also. What other defaults could be changed to reduce our waste? You could potentially think about maybe having your energy by default be renewable. I'm not gonna say that's gonna happen right away, but that's an option. And then you'd have to consciously opt out of that if you didn't wanna have renewable energy. We'd have a lot more people using renewable energy if we changed the way we think about it. So that's one option, or another, even better, depends how you define better, to be honest, but I would say even better, is choice editing. Just take away the options that are unsustainable. Don't give them that choice to opt in or out. So a fairly classic example of this is, some of you will remember, college students may not, detergent bottles. Used to be like giant, lugging around this huge detergent bottle. And now they're like tiny. They're 2x and 3x concentrated. Okay, well, when P&G rolled that out, Procter & Gamble rolled that out, nobody was buying the 2x concentrated because they looked at the bottle and they're like, I get twice as much for the same amount. I'm gonna get that one, except it was all water. So they just took out the old heavy bottle option that was full of water and said all detergents 2x concentrated. That's the only choice. And we adjusted. Maybe it took a little education about use half as much, et cetera, but we adjusted. So we can just take out choices. This is something Penn State hasn't done yet, but some campuses across company are partnering with a company called Companion, and Rutgers is one. They have gotten rid of all disposable cups, straws, and lids. Like, this is on their website. There will not be any paper cups, lids, or straws available to take out. Done, no more. That is awesome, in my world. That is awesome, right? So it is possible. Easy? Not so much, maybe. Yeah, you need to get yourself that app and remember your own cup, right? There's other things that we would need to go along with that, like the infrastructure. So that's something that some campuses have been doing. So Bates College in Maine. Now Rutgers is comparable to Penn State. Okay, don't like debate me on all these, but in terms of size, right? Bates College, Maine, not quite comparable in terms of size, but they got, every student got a reusable cup. They had the students surveyed to figure out what kind of cup they wanted. They wanted this particular type with a carabiner, so they could just hook it on the back of their backpack and have it the next time they wanted it, right? So it's simple, it's convenient. They also had the infrastructure. They installed mug washing stations. What's one of the biggest reasons you don't want to do it? Well, there's that like nasty coffee grime in it, and like I can't clean it easily, or I have to go to the bathroom. So we need the infrastructure, right? In order to be able to encourage these reusable and sustainable behaviors. But it's possible, right? We can do that. So that's one way we can think about reducing what we're doing. Another thing is thinking about purchasing the contents and not the packaging. So with beef, you're paying for the advertising, you're paying for the brand image, but you're also paying for some excessive packaging to go as part of it, right? So I'm gonna say all those toiletries or sample bottles, don't need them. Think about it and just say no and reuse. Yes, again, it's a little more effort. But once you go out and spend the $10 or less to purchase some reusable travel bottles, right? It's not that hard to just fill them up whenever they get empty. And all that hotel stuff stays there, right? Initially, hotels can also do this, right? It's not just on the consumer. Businesses can start to use more dispensers, right? So they can have the shampoo dispensers and the ketchup, you know, ask people, and you can ask companies to do this. Hey, I really wish that you would not be giving these out. I wish you'd have dispensers installed, right? If enough of us ask, they might actually get the message. And it's not necessarily that they don't want to, but sadly, they might not have even thought about it as an option. Just like we didn't think about something like, oh, I could do that. It wouldn't be that hard. They could do that. And guess what? It would probably be cost-saving for them too. Pitch it that way, and I bet you they'll latch on right away, right? So there are ways that we can actually think about, are we purchasing the content, what we really want, or are we paying for excessive packaging and also excessive waste, right? So another idea, which I would love to see this, if we have any entrepreneurs in the room that wants to open this up and stay college, please do. I would love to see a zero waste store. We don't have this option right now, but they're popping up in cities, well, across the US, but a lot of them, they're already in Canada, right, in Europe. We have zero waste stores now. Huge benefit. Now you're like, well, how does that even work? Well, you bring your own container. Bonus, it's more aesthetically pleasing, right? You'd rather see this than all the packaging in your cupboard or your pantry. And this is actually gonna substantially reduce the amount of waste. It's gonna change our mindset. It could also reduce the amount of food waste because we're buying the amount that we actually think we need, but we're also getting rid of all that packaging, the layers of packaging that can cause frustration and also end up in the landfill, right? So we have to think about what are we paying for. There are some options to do. My husband, by the way, he's become very sustainable. He now prefers to get his beer in a growler. We don't fill up the recycling bin. So that's his sustainability initiative, right? But it's true, right? Are you putting a lot of cans and bottles in the they are recycled, but it's still resources that are necessary versus just using the container. He's purchasing the contents rather than the container, right? You can do this for some other items at, say, farmers markets as well. And there are a few places that might sell a few items in bulk. But generally speaking, you could get one of these and you just take your own container, you weigh it, you get what you need, you're buying the contents, you're not buying the packaging. So something to think a little bit more about. The last thing I wanna talk about is reducing, well, not really reducing so much, but reducing our consumption simply by focusing on the quality and not the quantity. Now, something we've heard a lot about, but going back to the very beginning, of everything so cheap, we think that durables are disposable. I mean, if I asked you, is clothing durable? I think you'd all be like, yeah, absolutely. And then you think about the way we treat it. You're like, well, maybe not so much, right? So, I mean, when it's $3 at Walmart, obviously we have to buy it. No, we don't. We actually don't need to, right? So I would like you guys to think a little bit more about whether you're purchasing for quality or quantity. Now, I'm not suggesting that you need to go, you know, minimalist lifestyle. You can read lots of blogs online about, you know, I live for a year on 10 items of clothes or 20 items. That's the extreme end. Yeah, do it if you want, more power to you. I'm not saying you have to go that far, but I know some students, when we talk about this in class, be like, well, I can't afford to pay for these, you know, social welfare conscious, environmentally friendly brands of clothing, right? Well, you did afford that Louis Vuitton bag, and you actually afforded that so that they could pay to literally destroy the ones that don't get sold. Because that's how they keep their brand name and their scarcity, right? They produce more than they need. They don't sell them all, but they're not gonna give them away. They're not gonna donate them. They gotta literally destroy them, right? So that's what you're paying for. What if that hundreds of dollars was used to buy $100 on a pair of socially and environmentally conscious jeans and another 50, 60, or 100 on a couple socially conscious shirts, right? I think you could actually do it more than you think you could. Or what if those 70 clothing items you bought each year, what if you reduce that to 10 or even 20, but you paid 3 or 4 times as much and they lasted much longer because they're quality produced, right? Now, I know this brings up another boatload of issues in terms of, well, I like the latest fashion, I like this, I like that. I'm not saying it's gonna be easy, but can we at least reduce it? Can we at least be aware of it? Be conscious that we're doing it and try to start reducing it. And the other thing you can think about doing is at least repairing items or sending them back to some companies that will work with this. So there might be a lot more companies that are willing to repair than you're aware of. Now, obviously all of them are not, but how many of you knew JanSport would repair? Awesome. So my sister just did this. My nephew's backpack, getting ready for the school year, had a hole ripping it. She could buy a new one, but she knew they would do it. She sent it back, paid shipping and handling. They fixed it, sewed it, sent it right back to her. No new backpack to buy. Awesome, right? Cheaper for the consumer and much more sustainable, right? More and more companies are doing this. Patagonia, I know that's popular with many students and adults as well. They have a new division. You can send back your clothing from Patagonia to be repaired, but they also have a new division, Worn Wear, where you can send back and trade in your Patagonia clothes that you maybe no longer want, but they will repurpose and still sell, so other consumers that might not be able to afford that Patagonia price can get them at a reduced rate, but still a quality item that will last, right? There's another division, Eileen Fisher Renew. So if you're familiar with Eileen Fisher brand, they have a Renew, they're doing the same thing. You can send their clothes back, they will fix them. If they can't, they do give you new, but they're trying to increase the repair, reduce the waste that's happening overall. So something in clothing and accessories, but also in electronics, something we wanna think about. Planned obsolescence. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Heard it, yeah, right? So marketing, companies, business, they are the bad guys sometimes, right? Basically, I could say it's in part because consumers have said this is what they wanted. They want new things, they wanna buy the next version, but companies are also making their products so they're not repairable, right? That they don't want them to last that long, they're going to break easily. I mean, this is what my father preached to me all my life growing up, right? And now I'm in it. But basically, planned obsolescence still happening. I literally just read an article this morning about John Deere taking away farmers' rights to repair by basically saying they can fix some things, but they can't touch the software system. Well, everything is based on the software system, right? So if they can't update the software, they basically can't repair anything, right? So this was in California. Made me extremely sad because the reusable coffee mug, anyone that knows me knows that I carry around, has a John Deere logo on it. So I was a lot bit disappointed in reading that about John Deere. But thinking about what's relevant to many of you is smartphones, right? So I think we have a little video here on one company, Backmarket, that is trying to make the idea of refurbished a little bit cooler than it might have been before. You guys, but I thought that was a pretty cool commercial. I mean, it looks like an Apple commercial, right? Or pretty close, maybe it's not exactly an Apple, but it looks pretty close to an Apple commercial, right? So this is not to say that refurbished products, this is the first time anyone's refurbished a product, but currently I have got a colleague, Meg Malloy, in the marketing department as well, and she studied this, that consumers have feelings of disgust towards refurbished products, like we want it to be new and our own for the first time. We don't want to have this idea that someone else touched it or used it before, that it's not going to be as good. So a lot of companies are actually though starting to look into, I shouldn't say a lot, you know, you're gonna really challenge me on that one. How many is a lot? Well, some, right? We're making some progress on trying to have, so Backmarket is one of those companies that will offer, that you can go up to Fairphone too, that is trying to make this idea of getting a refurbished product, it still has a ton of value in it, right? It still has all the features you really need, and you're not shelling out $1,000 to get the latest iPhone, right? So there are options out there. Thinking of this idea of repair, Fairphone is another one. I'll let you play this video too. I think it's another 30 seconds or so. And then last video, if you're not a big fan of videos, last one. Company. Now, I'll admit, they're not readily available in the U.S., okay? I think a few people have them, but they have problems using them on the network, so it's not necessarily an option you can go get today or tomorrow. But there are companies that are starting to recognize that all of our electronic waste and our waste in general is just not sustainable. It's not maintainable, right? And they're starting to offer like a modular phone where basically you can, as new, you know, features come out, you can upgrade. You can take apart what you have, the old version, and you can insert the new version. It's more modular in that case, right? That's the kind of thing that we need to move towards. From a business perspective, there's still a business model there. They can still make money off of if you want to pay for the newest feature, but they're reducing all the waste that's created when we throw out the entire thing or recycle a small little piece of it and throw on everything else to get a new one, right? So there's still, it's not that it's impossible for business to make money or be profitable in order to have kind of what the customer wants, but have a lot less waste, right? It is possible. It's not the main model. We're still in that take, make, waste model, but we can get there with some time and I think with some consumer kind of pushback. So this is really kind of wrapping up here then. What you can do. First, I would just say, try to see your own waste, because I think that many of us don't realize how often we take that garbage bag out. Challenge yourself. Can you wait for an entire week to take the garbage bag out, right? There are families of four that live on those little jars of waste, right? Now, again, that's an extreme end. I'm not saying that needs to be you, or that you should feel guilty if it doesn't, but I think we can at least reduce substantially the amount of waste we put in there. And as you're trying to do that, say no. Consciously think about everything you pick up or take or get or buy, no matter how cheap it is. Do you need it? No. Do you want it? How bad? How much is it gonna make your life better? Nah, I'm good, thanks, I'll pass. Right? Many of the things we get, we really don't need or even want. And then plan for reuse. Use post-it notes to your advantage. They're recyclable. Use an app, right? Do something that will help you change your habit. There are little timers you could get to put in your shower to make you think consciously about how long you're showering, right? Can you reduce, now that's not necessarily saving the kind of consumer resources, but saving water, right? It just takes a little bit of change. Once you get used to showering in fewer minutes, that's your new norm. It's a habit. You don't have to think about it every time, right? So it's these little changes. We have to put in effort for 1, 2, maybe 3 weeks, and then it's effortless. So engage in that habit-changing behavior to start a new, less wasteful, more sustainable you. Think about times when you can actually choose to buy contents and not pay for the packaging. I'll admit that's not always an option right now. Certain products, you're gonna have to get packaging probably whether you like it or not, and we probably don't like it. But push, be a consumer that tries to be a little bit more of an activist and ask for those options. And also be more conscientious. The next time you see that $5 t-shirt and you're like, oh, why wouldn't I buy it? It's only $5. Wait, but do I need it? How many times am I gonna wear it? Is it gonna end up in my closet with tags on it anyway? Oh, no thanks, I'll pass, right? So trying to think through and be conscious of this. You know, when you put that disposable cup in and you have this little nagging bit of guilt, like right then and there, stop, get the app out, download, you know, and set it so you can change that behavior. Another thing I just kind of want to leave you with one final thought is that it's a lot of thinking. Basically, that's kind of all I'm hoping to do out of today is to get you to think a little bit more. So I found this quote and I liked it because what we've created is a process of our thinking. It's the way we think we need a disposable lifestyle. It's the way we think that throwaway living is the best, is convenient, right? But what if we changed our thinking? And if we also tried to speak up about what we wanted. Marketing, like I started out with, it's about driving sales. Companies, admittedly, are gonna be slow to change as long as their sales numbers are there, as long as their profit's going up. They have no motivation to change. But you know what makes heads turn in business? When sales go down. Somebody's gonna wake up, right? Then they're gonna pay attention. So if together, we band together and we stop just consuming what they're giving us, and we say no thank you, someone's gonna pay attention and say, we gotta change what we're doing because we're losing sales. And that's not acceptable to the business end, right? So you guys can do that by changing your own behaviors, changing your own habits. You know, Starbucks wants to get rid of disposable cups. They're not quite sure how to do it because the consumer demand is there. They don't have the best compost option. So if you tell them, look, I'm willing to change my habit and bring a reusable cup, no more disposable cups, right? They wanna do that, but we have to kind of help them along, tell them what we really want. So with that, that's really all I have. Oh, I do have to tell you, I have to promote, I have to do a little self-promotion. Last slide. So if you are excited by this and you want to learn more, there are two courses currently offered in SNEEL. I teach the second one, the one that's, you know, really highlighted here. I teach BA 442, and that's actually offered every spring. So you can sign up for that in October, whenever you register. But Eric Foley, fantastic guy, if you don't know him as well, he's the director of our sustainability in SNEEL. He teaches the first one, BA 441, and that's offered in the fall. If you're not sure, I'm gonna call out Allie here. I have a former student from last semester. And so if you're like, well, what's this BA 442 all about? Was it any good or should I avoid it? You could ask her when I'm not around and she'll give you some truth, okay, about what that class is like. But that's really all I have then. So I hope that really just, not to make you feel guilty, but to change the way you think so we can hopefully change our society by changing our own thinking. That's it. And shout out to Doug for being my clicker. Questions? Yeah, great question, and I don't have the answer to it. I'll try to comment on it. So the question basically was, you know, there's always these trade-offs that we face, and that's kind of like everything in life. Well, if I'm washing these disposable or these reusable napkins or the mugs, I'm using water, and if it's hot water, that's energy, and so I'm using all these other resources. Maybe it's not as efficient as I think it is or as environmentally friendly as it is. And that's a great question, and again, I don't have the answers. I always fall on this in my class. I'm like, well, I'm not really the scientist. I'm the social scientist, so go ask the scientists about that. But I do think that a lot of that education is necessary. I would just say, opinion, could be totally wrong, that most of the time, the resources, at least in the US, and that's definitely not globally, but you have the resources to say wash, and you're probably not aware, on average, of all of the resources it takes to make something from scratch, to create the water it takes to make a pair of jeans. Like, I should know this, it's like 400 gallons or something, I think, to make one pair of jeans, right? That's just the water. That's not the dye and the harmful chemicals that are poisoning the workers and the factory because they don't have safety. You know, it goes on and on and on and on, right? So I would say that, generally speaking, use the energy and water resources to reuse. But it's definitely a question that gets asked, and it's also an easy out for not being more reusable. Oh, well, you know, it takes more water, I guess. I'm not going to really invest the effort in that. I think that companies could definitely, they probably have the best because they have the money and the reach on average. You know, big advertisements. So Colgate, I think it was Colgate, who wasn't Crest, you're going to get in trouble. A toothpaste brand during the Super Bowl, I think it was 2 years ago, did a whole campaign about turning the water off when you brush your teeth, right? So they have the money to do that huge, you know, millions of dollars advertising to reach people to change that kind of attitude and get that thinking going. So I would say companies can do that, but we have to kind of push them to be held responsible. So maybe it's someone, you know, selling a reusable product and telling, having a whole campaign launched around, well, you think it's going to take, you know, this much water to use it, but actually, guess what? It takes X amount of resources to make it from scratch, so you should buy our brand. You know, that's more sustainable. So kind of doing it in that manner, I mean, that may sound a little tacky, right? Like, oh, there's business again, just advertising, you know, but that's what business is, but doing it to also educate the public. I mean, local governments can do it as well, or national governments, probably not ours right now, but governments in general could do that, right? Local governments could do that, but they might not have the money to get the reach out, right? I don't know if I answered it. Like I said, I don't have the answer from the beginning, I told you straight up, but it's a great question. Any other ones? Do you have a comment to that? I was like, she looks like she wants to say something.
Boulder or like a different state, they don't even have that option.
I get that, but
they don't offer that.
I know, I'm asking how do you get it? Get it in? I'm not saying I don't know that. How, like in Center County, how do we go approach it and get the stores to not make it an option?
Just do it, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's going to be a little bit of pushback, right? Like you have to convince them that that's what they're constituent or their consumer wants, right? But I think it also have to come a little bit from just recognizing, like, if it's a chain store, right? It's gonna be like, well, this is what our company policy, like, just be realistic, right? You're gonna face a lot, they're gonna face a lot of hurdles to get that behavior changed as well. But I think all consumers kind of pushing back against it and not using it, and trying to maybe not just talk to the local manager, but you're really trying to, I think, initiate change at a higher level, right? So you've gotta start talking with the executives. The local manager is going to say, well, I got to report to them, right? And so you've got to talk to a higher level. and using examples that are already doing it that you know about, but also trying to use local competition. So if you know someone that's starting to do it, pit them against, hey, guess what? This store's doing it, and we're gonna shop there unless you guys do it too. So if you can find someone local that's kind of setting that tone or that bar, try to pit the competition against them, right? But otherwise, I'm not sure that I have like the exact perfect answer to how do you get them to just be like, sure, we'll take away our plastic bags. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And have an extra bagger there to bag your bags. Mm-hmm. So everybody else would be seeing these two lanes that are maybe moving more frequently.
Yeah.
With no plastic in it, and they're helping you pack your bags.
That's a great idea. Mm-hmm. That's a great idea, because many of the things we think about in terms of how do you change behaviors is you can either increase the benefits of the behavior you want to see, or you can increase the barriers to the behavior you don't want to see. So make their line longer and nobody bags their groceries, right? That's a barrier that they're not gonna wanna have to face suddenly, but that's not really making the business change so much as making the consumers want to change. But ultimately, if they're seeing everyone in that line, they may be like, let's get rid of these bags. We don't need them, right? So it might be those little baby steps that take to make the ultimate change you're looking for. It's not gonna be a flip of a switch, yeah. Yeah, I'll admit, I don't think that's a good business plan. I mean, yes, Apple is thriving, generally speaking, so clearly I'm not in charge of them. But I don't think that that's a smart marketing tactic. I mean, consumers are smart too, and they caught on to it. They figured it out, and they called them out on it. But to be honest, if we say we don't like that, and we go buy their next phone, they're not gonna change. You gave them no motivation to change, right? Because you said something, but your actions spoke much louder. You just shelled out $1,000 for the new iPhone or whatever it is. I don't know, I've never owned one in my life. So I mean, I have a smartphone, but I've never owned an Apple, I don't know. But I know that they're expensive, right? So it's gonna be a behavior change. It's gonna be you saying, this is unacceptable, and guess what, I'm not buying your phone anymore. And when enough people do that, they're gonna be like, whoa, we can't get away with this anymore. But right now, we as consumers are letting them basically get away with it. We're saying we don't like it, but we're not willing, in my opinion, to step back and say, it's okay if I don't have the coolest, latest, greatest thing. I'm willing to settle for something slightly less. We as consumers have to accept that we're willing to settle for something a little bit less to actually maybe prove our point. I don't know if that answers your question or not. Yeah. Yes, absolutely, and there's other business reasons that they're considering, right? I don't even know all of them. I'm not gonna act like I do, like I'm not in their boardroom, right? But they're thinking about the consumer pushback from the ones that wanna have, so what about the family that comes to visit Penn State's campus and they don't have a reusable coffee mug with them and they don't wanna have to buy one, and so they wanna have a disposable cup for them, and they're thinking about all the other options or the pushback that Starbucks is gonna get if they take them away entirely. But I agree, it's a framing issue, kind of thinking the default option. So in that case, it really is already there. It's just the way they're framing it. So, and it may not be the magnitude that we need, but you can get like from 10 cents to 25 cents or more discount for bringing a reusable mug. So your coffee's gonna cost a little bit less. Did you know that? I know my students last year didn't know that. But it may not be enough. It's not marketed, it's not communicated. They could do the same thing and flip it. And And that would have a huge change on behavior, right? Instead of saying you get 25 cents when you bring one, you have to pay 25 cents to get one. It's the exact same thing, right? It's just the way they frame it. And they haven't done it. And I don't know all the reasons why, but I'm gonna, you know, there's a lot more there than just like, oh, change that and everybody will love it. No, some people are gonna hate it, they're gonna be really mad and it's gonna cause an uproar, you know, tweeting and so there's some reasons why I'm thinking about it. But if you guys push that more and more, not just you guys, you know, but if as in general, if Starbucks customers are saying this is ridiculous, stop, they might hear that as it gets louder and louder. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and so I just put the stuff in my pocket. I hadn't thought about that before. And so from that day, like, I kind of changed my habit, I guess.
Yeah, I just made it. It's the default option here. Like, here's the bag. You will take it. Oh, well, we could be conscientious about that and actually not just do the default anymore. That's, I honestly did not know that. So that is new knowledge to me. But that absolutely, I mean, you'll read about executives saying that they want this to happen. They want these, you know, labor standards or environmental standards. But meanwhile, they're paying, you know, companies that will fight that or lobby, you know, to fight that. And so sadly, it's not as simple as, you know, there's other consequences that happen with those changes. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely, and I'm glad you brought that up because I totally agree with that. I actually have a research project on it right now, why people don't do that, but I agree it's totally the right thing, and I'm sorry that I didn't mention earlier because, yeah, don't just go buy Patagonia because they're a better brand. Actually, buy the reused Patagonia or buy something from Goodwill store. That's definitely better. I totally agree. Great tips, yeah. And so we do have some options like that. I think, and those are great. I'm glad you're making people aware of those. They're gonna be more inconvenient for many, right? And so part of this is over us putting in the effort to overcome the convenience factor, but making it more convenient where I can maybe buy my oats in bulk, but I can't get this or that. So some is better than none. Hear me out. But I think that is, sorry.
See, these are reusable straws, right? But the packaging, that is like one of the things that Kara was mentioning before. That was a choice that we could personally make. They send it anyways for like health reasons, so like you can't get bacteria or whatever on the straw. So unfortunately, like, we can't opt out of that plastic packaging, or else we would, obviously.
Okay. The answer is a benefit-cost relationship. The benefit of giving away the straws is higher than the cost of recycling or the plastic.
But I really love this discussion that this conversation sparked, and I encourage you guys to continue having this with friends, family members, people that you don't even know, as well as Karen. She'll stick around for a few minutes, but we're going to just start wrapping up, and feel free to grab a straw on the way out.
Just saying.
There's also a few meals left over, so if you go outside, you can grab one if you haven't gotten a lunch or anything. But thank you guys so much for coming today. And next week we have Maya K. Van Rossum, who is like an environmental lawyer. So feel free to come out for that one as well. I hope to see you there. Have a good day.